Hello people, welcome to my channel Gurukula. I am Jai. So today in this channel we are going to see about the propagation mechanisms and what do you mean by propagation models and what are the types of models that we have to measure the propagation. So if you like this video, do press the like button. If you unlike the video, do press the like button so that I'll consider it as a feedback, and do subscribe to my channel. So now without any further delay, let us get into the topic. As an introduction, to transmit my messages wirelessly, the key components of wireless communications are: we need a transmitter and we need a receiver. So in these two players, that is transmitter and then the receiver, will exchange the informations in a form of electromagnetic waves. So here in this topic we need two terms to be considered. One is the channel. So channel is nothing but it is a medium through which the signal is transferred from one point to another point. And then secondly, propagation. So propagation is nothing but the tendency of electromagnetic wave to travel from one place to another place. So in connection to today's video, we are going to see much more deeper into the propagation. How does my signal propagates? What are all the mechanisms behind it? And what are all the effects behind the propagation? We will see in detail in this particular video. And if you have not seen my wireless introduction, I will leave a link in the I button so that you can check out the introductory video, so which will cover the concepts such as fading, shadowing, etc. So now we will see what exactly the propagation mechanisms are and what are all the effects of propagations. So propagation mechanism. So we all know that the signal is not going to reach my receiver in a line of sight. So every time line of sight communication is not possible in wireless communication, because we will have much more of obstacles between transmitter and then the receiver. So we all know that my signal is going to get reflected by various obstacles present in between the transmitter and then the receiver. It may be a building, it may be a lamppost, or it may be a vehicle that is running on the road. So whenever my signal hits on the obstacle, there are three possible effects that would happen to the signal, and it is completely based on the surface on which my signal is getting impinged. So for an example, let us consider this particular picture. You could see that the transmitter is radiating the waves and it is hitting on an obstacle. So depending upon the surface of the obstacle, my signal may get three particular effects. So three particular effects is nothing but, the first one is reflection. So when does a reflection occurs? The reflection occurs whenever my signal is getting impinged on a smooth surfaces. So what do you call as a smooth surfaces or a large surfaces? So large in a sense in terms of wavelength. So if the surface's wavelength is much more larger when compared to my wavelength of the signal, then the signal will get reflected back. So this is one among the propagation mechanism. And then the second mechanism is diffraction. So diffraction will happen whenever my signal hits a sharp edge. So whenever my signal hits a sharp edge, then the diffraction would happen, and diffraction would cause the bending of signals. So that this could be considered on a positive sense, like whenever your transmitter is radiating in a hilly area and your radio waves is hitting a particular sharper edge, then the signal will get diffracted and it will get bended up, so that the points or the receiver that is in the valley point is going to get a proper signal. So this could be considered in that effect as well. But do consider, whenever my signal hits on any obstacle, it is going to lose some of its energy, it is going to get weaker, and the same thing happens in all of these effects as well. So that's all about diffraction. And the third mechanism through which my signal propagates is the scattering. So scattering occurs whenever my signal impinges on an rough surfaces. Rough surfaces in a sense, when in an unit area, when there are quite a lots of obstacles, and like a spike or like a lamppost that is available on roads. So everything will impinge, scattering losses. So these are the three mechanisms which will be imposed on the propagation of my radio waves. Now, what is the need for propagation model? So why do we need a propagation model? So all these propagation mechanisms will have different effects on the propagating radio waves. So when you get back the image over here, so you could see that when I assume that my receiver is over somewhere over here, then this particular receiver is going to get the reflected wave, the scattered wave and as well as the diffracted wave, which means my receiver is going to get multiple copies of the radiation that is radiated from the transmitter side. So it is nothing but the same message but in different versions of it. We call that as multipath components. So reflected wave will be acting as one component, scattered wave will be acting as one component, and the diffracted wave will be acting as one component. Since we are receiving signals from multiple paths, we are calling that as multipath components. And we have very well know that each and every time my signal hits an obstacle, it is going to change its phase, and also there is going to be a considerable loss of energy, so that my signal is going to get weaker. And the receiver that is present over here, when it is an ideal receiver, my receiver could not able to differentiate whether it is an interface component or it is an multipath component. My receiver will just going to sum up all the signals that is received at the receiver end. So what happens over here? As we know that the reflection is going to get decayed at some level, scattered is going to get decayed at some level, and diffracted wave is going to decayed at certain level. So when I sum it up, what will be the final output? What will be the power of signal that I receive at the receiver end? So as a communication engineer, my first and foremost question before designing any wireless communication system would be, what amount of signal do I receive at the receiver side? So that will be the major question which I have to answer first. So in order to answer this question, I need to somehow measure what will be the received power at the receiver side, and considering all these reflection, scattering, diffraction and all other fadings that occurs in between my transmitter and then the receiver. So that's where the propagation model comes into the picture. So now our key challenge is to measure or to estimate what will be the amount of signal that I receive at the receiver end. So possibly there are multiple methods to estimate the received signal. So basically two types. First one is empirical method. So in empirical method, what we have to do is we will be duplicating the entire scenario again, or we have to replicate the entire scenario. The transmitter should be actually present, the receiver should be actually present, and we need to send a test signal between transmitter and then the receiver by considering all the obstacles, and then we can predict what is the amount of signal that I received at the receiver side. So this is one method, but this sounds quite impractical because we could not implement all of the real world situations, and we cannot replicate all of the real world situations as real, and it is much more expensive. So this method is not used in most of the cases. So the another option what we have is the propagation model. This is the propagation model is nothing but it is a mathematical formulation of the radio wave which is transmitted from one point to other point. So here all the obstacles will be considered but in a mathematical form. So you will have a mathematical formulation for all the obstacles, and you will have a transmitter, you will have a receiver, and quite a lot of parameters is also involved, like transmitted power, what is the modulation scheme that we have used, everything can be modeled in a form of equations, and then we can estimate the received power at the receiver side. So the propagation models, why do we need propagation models? We get quite a good amount of advantages over here. So the propagation model, it is easy to design, simulate and then plan the wireless systems. So when I want to design a wireless system, if I have a propagation model, which means when I have a model of the medium which is going to carry my signals, I could easily design, I could easily simulate, and I can plan my wireless communications. So propagation model, it will reflect the properties of the propagation channel. So since the wireless channel characteristics are dynamic in nature, we cannot sum up with one propagation model which satisfies all of the propagation mediums, because my channel is going to be a dynamic one, because the nature of the channel is going to get varied on several parameters. It may be based on time, or it may be based on the frequency as well. So that the level of fading is also going to get changed depending upon time to time. So we cannot predict one propagation model for all wireless communications, which means we should have different propagation models for different environments and for different situations. So modeling a radio channel decides the coverage area, modulation schemes to be used, and also we can check out how we can optimize the communication parameters. Types of propagation model. The propagation model purely based on the fading. So what level of fading will I use? Am I going to measure the received signal? Anyhow, any kind of propagation models is going to measure only the received power at the receiver side. So only thing that we have to consider is, am I going to measure the received signal in an outdoor environment or in an indoor environment, or what kind of environment that I am going to transmit my messages. So initially let us consider that we are going to develop different propagation model based on different fading conditions. So when you check out the types of fading, the fading is broadly classified into two types. One is small scale fading and another one is large scale fading. So let us put some more light on small scale fading. So small scale fading is nothing but it is a measure of the received power signal when a user moves over a very short distance, that means within a room. So whenever a user moves within a room, then there will be an instantaneous fluctuation in the received power. There will be a rapid fluctuation in the received power. And these kinds of rapid fluctuations, even though the user moves over a small period, we call that as small scale fading. And the small scale fading models are used to predict the average received power at the receiver when the receiver moves over a very short range. As I already said, when a user moves within a room. And on the other side, we have large scale fading models. So large scale fading is nothing but the amount of signal that is getting faded because of the distance between the transmitter and then the receiver. When I increase the distance between transmitter and then the receiver, then my signal is going to get attenuated accordingly. So this fading is what we refer to as large scale fading. So which is going to happen over a very large distance. So when compared to small scale fading, so, and the large scale fading models are used to predict the same average received power at the receiver, but this time we are going to consider only the distance between the transmitter and then the receiver. So that is all about the types of fading that we have. So when we see a small scale fading and then the large scale fading, when you put it on a graph, we will get this. So here you could see that whenever a distance moves, when we take a transmitter and then the receiver separation on x-axis and then we take the received power on y-axis, we could see that when a user moves from 14 meters to 16 meters, which means if a user moves 2 meters distance, then you could see that there is a rapid fluctuations, which is represented in the black line. So this rapid fluctuations is what we refer to as small scale fading. So you could see the rapid fluctuations even if there is a small, very small change. The user just moved only 2 meters. And then you could see a gradual decrease starting from 14 to 28. You could observe the gradual decrease of the signal power only if you go for a larger distance. When the user goes up to 28 meters from the transmitter, then you could see a gradual decrease in the received power. And the blue line, that is what we represent as large scale fading. So that is the difference, key difference between small scale fading and as well as the large scale fading. So depending upon these types of fading, we will be developing certain models to predict what will be the received power at the receiver side. So in order to sum up, we have seen an introduction of wireless communication, just a brush up, and then we have seen what are all the propagation mechanisms that we have. So we have reflection, diffraction, and then scattering, and what are all the propagation models that we have, what are all the types of propagation models that we have. And we have seen the uses of propagation models. So it is easy to plan, decide, and maintain my wireless communication systems. And finally, we have seen what is a small scale fading and what is a large scale fading. So we have seen these concepts in this particular video. So that's the end of the video. So remaining concepts, so I will be posting as a different video. So please do check out my channel for much more interesting technical videos, and please do consider subscribing as well. Thank you. We will see in the next video. Until then, happy learning.